Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining today's 2021 GIF Summit. I'm proud to introduce our greatest speaker for this topic, Dr. Mike Rosenblatt. Mike is a senior partner of Flagship Pioneering, leading its global clinical development and medical affairs. He plays a key role in Flagship's internal venture creation team during the conception and the launch of the next generation of pioneering biotechnology companies. He also serves as an ongoing strategic resource for all companies in the Flagship ecosystem by supporting their clinical development strategies. We'll start the section by Mike's introductory talk for life science innovation, followed by a conversation moderated by myself. Good to see you, Mike, and thank you so much for being with us.
Well, thank you, Ella. Thank you very much for inviting me to give a talk and have a conversation with you. I'm very honored to participate in this GIF Summit. And what I thought I would do would be, as you mentioned, just give a little talk with some of my thoughts about innovation. And that could be just a starting point for our conversation, and then we'll go from there. So I'll just begin with the premise that, you know, we need all kinds of innovation in healthcare. It's so complicated, all the components that contribute to having a healthy population. And we need a mix of both incremental advances and innovation, which kind of improve things that we already have or can imagine. And we also need breakthroughs, which make major contributions to health. And we need them in healthcare delivery, in clinical technologies like diagnostics and imaging, in the biopharma area for sure, new therapeutics and devices, and the growing area of digital health. I think what's characteristic of breakthrough as opposed to incremental is there's a discontinuity from what we have currently to something that is very new, and it's hard to draw a direct line to it from where we are. And in that, very often is an opportunity to create a lot of value. So one of the questions that I think we can ask of our colleagues and of our field is, why aren't there more breakthrough innovations in biopharma? And I'll talk about that a little bit and also make some general recommendations for how we can spur innovation. And part of it actually is just simply getting out of the way. Don't stifle innovation. And I can talk about things that we do that inadvertently stifle innovation. And then I will speak about Flagship, as you mentioned, Ella, Flagship Pioneering as an example of an institutionalized approach to innovation. So let's begin with just what I mean by innovation. So take a huge problem. We're in the midst of a pandemic now, and it's an acute illness that is affecting the population globally. But there are some slow epidemics also, like Alzheimer's, that is growing and growing in numbers and really threatens not only health, but the very fabric of society. And what we need to address that is not just a better performing health system, better healthcare, better nursing, et cetera, but we need inventions, which are a special category of innovation that would either slow down the progression of the disease, prevent it, or even hopefully treat it. So that's the kind of thing I'm talking about, inventions, things you can touch and feel. And how can we create more innovative ones, breakthroughs in this category? And in truth, we operate, although everybody, almost every company you talk to is interested in, says that they're committed to, dedicated to innovation. In fact, we operate in a context where there are force fields that work against that. So in most established companies, once they have their first product, they're trying to defend a therapeutic area. And that confines you to a narrow corridor of innovation. So if there are breakthroughs in basic science, in the sciences fundamental to medicine, in a different area, unless you can see a way to apply them to your therapeutic area, you won't work on them. So there's an opportunity cost for innovation in that situation if you were to leave your therapeutic area and take advantage of a scientific breakthrough. Commercially, although everybody wants a breakthrough, in fact, it's faster and easier to have an incremental advance, and commercial is often satisfied with that. So management asks for breakthroughs, but they're often pretty happy to settle for an incremental advance. Then there's the kind of, if you really want to work on breakthroughs, you often go into an area where you're alone. And that opens you up to doubt and criticism. And so the gravitation, what I call the gravitational force field of people working in the same area, it gives you the sense of validation. If you could say, well, we're working on this and so is company X and so are company Y, you have a sense that that must be important and that must be worthwhile working on. But breakthrough innovation would require you to move away from the areas where other people are working. Also, it's very easy to kind of outsmart yourself and put a premature emphasis on practical issues like manufacturing hurdles, cost, things like that. And also the way we organize ourselves. We organize ourselves by departments that usually represent disciplines, but it's often the interfaces between these disciplines where innovation, big innovation occurs, and you need multidisciplinary teams. I like this graphic that I'm showing you now because I think it tells the story in a way of us maybe not realizing it, but talking out of both sides of our mouth when it comes to innovation. So we say we want innovation on the left, but breakthrough innovation is hard to imagine before it's occurred. And it seems the premises seem unreasonable. And so if you come with an idea that's potentially a breakthrough, an idea that's unreasonable, then usually there's an internal review committee to fund a project or approve a project, or sometimes we bring in external people to help us with this. And their job is to de-risk. I'm sure you've all heard that phrase, to de-risk the projects. You can look very smart by saying why something won't work. But all of these ideas at the beginning, they're risky. So if you de-risk them too much, you won't get breakthrough innovation or invention. So, you know, currently life science, the tent is gigantic, and there's room for more than one approach to inventing drugs and therapies. And so I'm going to tell you about one of them, one that I've been immersed in for the last 5 years, the approach that we take at Flagship Pioneering. And it's just an example. So just to be clear, I'm not saying that this is the best way or the only way to innovate, but I hope that you'll extract some principles from it that might be applicable to your own situation. And I also want to say at the outset that we're not, strictly speaking, a venture capital company. In fact, our name used to be Flagship Pioneering and Flagship Ventures, and we were confused with venture capital companies. So we changed it to Flagship Pioneering. We have our own laboratories and our own scientists, and our products are new companies that we create, and we create them in that setting, own labs, own scientists. So We have a very structured, rigorous approach to innovation. For some people, that might sound dissonant. You know, innovation is creative and it can't be structured, but we believe that it can be structured. We believe that you can stimulate it, that you can organize to do it, and that it doesn't come just from some inexplicable spark that comes to one particular scientist. We have a unified philosophy, which I'll speak on, which has several principles. And we have a very specific methodology that all of our companies, we've created in the past 20 years, about 100 companies. We're active in about 40 companies now. Almost all of them have come through the same methodology, regardless of what kind of company they are at the end. And this, of course, is sustained by having a culture that supports innovation, a key ingredient in the secret sauce. So I want to contrast what we do with the approach that's used by, I don't know, 95, 98% of the world, an approach that clearly works, and we don't have any criticism of it, but it's different than what we do. So imagine that you're working in the field of cancer. And on the left, there's a diagram that shows you a picture of the continent of cancer knowledge. So all the knowledge in cancer is encompassed in this one field that's circumscribed. And then your lab or somebody else's lab makes an advance that changes the shape, changes the border of the continent. And then what typically happens is that that lab or many others start examining that insight and they say, well, is there a way that I can move that all the way to the right to a new therapy for people? Can I translate that? And this is a way that works, but it requires a very big base and a kind of stochastic process of throwing out many possibilities, very few of which actually can go most of the way. Now, in this model, we have to ask ourselves, why would we expect extraordinary inventions? Why would we expect breakthroughs from reasonable people who are doing reasonable things, meaning that they're just moving to the edge and doing what you could imagine would be the next logical step? What we try to do at Flagship Pioneering is a different approach. So the bottom left here is our two circles that shows you where most of biomedical research is occurring, called current solutions. And then there are some people, as I said, who are really working on the cutting edge and making advances. So these people, all of them operate in a zone where risk and reward can be measured and compared. But discontinuous innovation doesn't operate there. We go off into this white space where all the dots are. And this is really unknown territory. And we work in this area until we can find a way back into a field like oncology or another field. So, you know, the notion that all of the innovation space is just a step away from what we currently are exploring simply can't be right. In fact, the largest opportunity is in the white space outside of the known. And that's where we choose to work. And the rules that we apply to working there are just a few. One is, and I know this sounds a little Pollyannish, but we actually only will take on ideas that we think have the potential to transform some part of medicine. We will only work on product platform companies. And by that, I mean, we don't start a cancer company or a rheumatology company. We create platforms which we think can go into multiple different therapeutic areas. And if you're going to be doing risky business like this, you want to have a chance to bring back more than one product from your initiative. To go in white space, that means you're going into an area where very little is known. There's very little competition, and that's your starting point. In fact, it's best for us if there's actually no data to support the idea. Let me say that again, because I think that's the hardest thing here of all of it to swallow, which is we start at a place where there are no data to support the idea. So, could you imagine, let's say, proposing to your research management that we start a project in which there aren't any publications and no preliminary data? I can tell you, if that was a grant in academia going to the NIH, it would not fare well. Or if I proposed such a project inside a large pharmaceutical company, no publications, no data, that would probably end my career. So we start in a place where we're free of current dogma. And almost all of our companies start with a single question. And we can talk about this later, Ella, some of our companies, you know, how do we start them? We start with a question, what if? And the solutions to these are often, or almost always, unreasonable. And then because they're unreasonable, we apply a rigorous methodology, and we wind up with a potential solution called it turns out. So what if? Well, it turns out. And here's a schematic of the process that we use. Almost all of our companies have gone through this process. So we begin all the way on the left in what we call an exploration, where we've asked the question, what if? And we answer it with possible solutions. And during this period of time, we're not allowed to do an experiment. It's a small team, 2, 3, 4 people. And all we do is think about solutions to the question, what if? And it's an evolutionary model. We create variation on the answers, and then we select. And then we take what we select and we create variations on it. So it's a natural selection process. And the idea, the solution, possible solutions, all theoretical at this point, after a year, if the idea is still worthwhile, we will advance. Another part of this process, which is really key, is during this time, we talk to 30 to 50 people, some of whom are experts in the field because they know the field, but they also are the people who've created the dogma for the field. So they do have a particular lens of way of looking at it. And we talk to non-experts who are smart, but aren't indoctrinated, if you will, into the dogma. And an interesting thing is, you know, if you go and you talk to experts and say, give me your best ideas, you're not going to get very far. But you can go to them with your own idea and say, tell me what's wrong with it. And people love to tell you, experts love to tell you what's wrong with your idea. So this works very well. And then if the idea still looks like it's worth pursuing, then for the first time, we start to do experiments. We call this a protoco. And our goal here, unlike typical venture capital, which has an asset in a startup, and if it doesn't work, let's say for ulcerative colitis, then let's try it for rheumatoid arthritis. We pivot, trying to hold on to that asset and make it work. We don't have allegiance to any single field. And so we try to kill it. We try to kill it as quickly as possible. So give these proto-companies numbers instead of names, because if you started, let's say, Ella Therapeutics, and then you killed it, you know, you'd have to go back to your family, Ella, and explain to them they killed Ella Therapeutics. But if we killed flagship number 72, it's not the same thing. And you can wait and join the next one, flagship 76 or something. And then after about a year and a half more, so now almost 3 years have elapsed. At that point, if we have not killed the idea, we stand up a company and we recruit in a CEO, a chief scientist, chief financial officer, et cetera. And all of this time, we're the only ones capitalizing these companies. I don't say invest because we don't invest in them. They're our companies and we capitalize them. So we also believe that this innovation is best done by teams. It can be taught, it can be learned, it can be replicated, same process over and over again. And so, you know, if you, when you start this process and you have these ideas that are really out there, and then you wind up with a product, ironically, I like this phrase from, of all people, Vladimir Lenin, what before was thought to be impossible, afterwards seems obvious or inevitable. And that's the story for many of our companies. So this is my last slide, and then I'm looking forward to the conversation with you, Ella, which is, you know, my recommendations are in general here are do your best to create a culture that tolerates flawed ideas, because really innovative ideas don't start out perfectly hatched, and make it acceptable to consider the unreasonable. We believe innovation, in particular inventions, can be fostered. Yes, we recognize it's important to de-risk. We de-risk by having a platform and by having rigorous methodology. We form interdisciplinary teams. We try basically to get out of the way. And if you're going to take a high-risk approach, then you have to be very disciplined in how you execute it.
Very insightful section, I have to say, Mike. I also learned a lot. I put a lot of note. So Mike, now I want to switch the gear a little bit. So several years ago, you transitioned to Flagship Pioneering. What are the most important things you needed to learn from this change?
Well, I'm glad you asked that question. There are several things I needed to learn. First of all, I needed to change the way that I begin to think about addressing the medical problem and creating a company. And it have to start from a place where you can imagine something that we don't have now. You're not sure what. And then work your way backwards to the problems that you could solve if that were true. In general, we usually work the other way around. So I had to change that. And the other thing is that mostly I had to unlearn. So it was not just learning, but I had to unlearn a set of reflexes that I had to say, to be very skeptical, say, well, that won't work, so I won't try it. Or here's a set of problems that I can think of just like that. And because I can think of this set of problems, I shouldn't work on something. Those are hard lessons to learn. And they're so deep inside of us because of the way we train that I still now, 5 years later, catch myself every once in a while thinking in a way that fits for a different environment and doesn't fit for Flagship.
Now, Moderna has already become a household name across the globe, but it's just one of the dozen portfolios that Flagship has launched. So can you please walk with us through the example of Moderna or any other portfolio or company that you have given birth to from the beginning to the spin-off moment?
Well, although Moderna, in terms of public awareness, made a sudden appearance on the stage, we shouldn't be fooled to thinking that it's an overnight success. So Moderna was working on in this field for 10 or 11 years. It took them a long time. I think in terms of funding, they went all the way through Series G before they went public. And but it comes from the same pedigree that I spoke of in our laboratories, the initial. So it begins with the question, what if? And the question, what if, at that time was, what if you could convert the body into a mini factory to make things that the body could use. How would you do it? And they looked at many possibilities of answers to the what if question. And as we all know now, they settled on mRNA. Now, it's a very good example of this process because most of the scientific world, not everyone, but most of the scientific world thought that although mRNA conceptually was very attractive, it was impractical for a couple of reasons. One reason was that it is degraded so quickly, it's cleared so quickly that it seemed impossible to get enough mRNA into a cell, keep it stable, and have it provide the information for a cell to produce something. And secondly, and this is a little less known, but naked mRNA is quite inflammatory so that you would have side effects. So most scientists in the beginnings were quite negative about this. In fact, many of them right up until the vaccine started to work. So it's an example of, you know, the experts saying it won't work and much of the scientific community saying it won't work, and they persevered. They were able to use, and in some cases license, technology from synthesizing more stable mRNA, mRNA analogs, if you will. But a key part of what they did, which people talk about less, is to put that mRNA in lipid nanoparticles. And that's a key ingredient of this technology that took a long time to develop. And it has some very attractive properties. It protects the mRNA and it gets it into the cell. And actually, and this was fortuitous, it's something of an adjuvant. So it actually stimulates the immune system and helps with the vaccine. So Moderna worked on both of those things. It's called an mRNA vaccine, but it actually, it's a package. It's the mRNA. And so they worked in this moving in different areas. And because they were developing the platform, they were able to move very quickly to the coronavirus. The coronavirus had not been on their radar screen. It was on very few people's radar screen, but it was, and then they were able to move very quickly. And everybody knows how fast they moved. I was involved in the vaccine effort. I don't think any corners were cut in terms of the clinical trials, in terms of safety and efficacy. But if you think of what Moderna did, so they had no products. This is a company that had no products. And they had limited bandwidth. And they moved away from projects that were ahead of it that they were working on and took the opportunity cost potentially of slowing those down and moving. And they didn't know the things now that we know now, like, first of all, could you make enough protein? Would it fold correctly? If it were produced by a cell continuously for 2 to 4 weeks, as opposed to one exposure to antigen, would that make for a better immune response or a worse immune response? What if the efficacy were only 60%? We wouldn't be walking around the way we are now, but that would have been better than nothing. What if, as everyone predicted, it didn't work so well in the elderly, who were the most vulnerable, but worked in everyone else? So all these things came out just the way we had hoped. There were no guarantees. And now in the end, everybody takes it for granted and says, it's obvious, mRNA, and look how great it is, et cetera. But there was a deep commitment by the leadership of the company big investment in capital, so a scientific commitment, a capital equipment commitment. And I think that's the Moderna story. And now they have a platform, right? And this platform can make not only potentially other vaccines, but biologicals, antibodies, hormones, et cetera. So it's very exciting. We'll see where it goes. And they are, of course, very much informed and encouraged by their first product.
Yeah, I do remember a couple of years ago, Moderna seems already pretty popular as a really pioneering mRNA company. But back then, the concept was still skeptical for many people. Yes. As exactly what as what you mentioned about the delivery method, about the efficacy related with the degradation time, how stable would that be, and also the potential application. But back then, Moderna was already the leading company in the sector. It also went through also quite a journey to get
yes.
here.
Yes, and I don't want to, I do want to, I maybe didn't emphasize enough. Of course, there was scientific inquiry, and they were able to build on that, some of which started in academia. So even their 11 years of work didn't start alone. There were others working on this foundation. And you know, that's what you hope will happen in this large biomedical enterprise globally, that there's a foundation that can go in directions that we didn't predict it would have to go.
Now I want to talk about this, the de-risking part or the challenging part. So you must, there must be also a lot of challenges and there are also hurdles that you have during the process of company launching. So can you comment on that?
Well, we have a couple of big mechanisms for de-risking. I mentioned that the platform itself is a way of de-risking because we have an opportunity with one technology to move into more than one therapeutic area. So that's one mechanism. Secondly, we have this rigorous methodology that I described, which at each junction you get to review and stop. So many of the things that we start, you never get to see. It's what comes out has been as de-risked as is possible in biology, which is not very de-risked. But so that's another mechanism. We're very strict about that. We review our early stage companies before they come out of stealth mode very rigorously and determine whether to invest in them more or how to reshape them. That's another de-risking. But we don't apply the same kind of thing that I'm used to of in academia study section review, which comes up with all the reasons why, all the problems, or in a big company where you say, well, we don't want to spend our time on this because the probability of success is lower than the probability of success of something else in the same field. We don't do that probability of success analyses. Once we let the idea go where it will take us, we just put guardrails on it to make sure it can go forward, but not kind of go off track. So it's a much less of a de-risking because of the way that we've gone about it with platform and with all of the stages of review.
So strategy is also very, very important to differentiate the flagship from other funds. I'm also curious, Mike, so of course, like the big domain knowledge of all the staff from flagship, also like yourself, is really also the key to achieve success of flagship. So why do you think this model cannot be copied by other fund? What if, let's say, I run a healthcare fund, what if I also recruit a lot of scientists to take the same strategy? Why there's only a very, very, very few healthcare venture are willing to take this approach?
Well, I don't. Well, first of all, we don't want everyone to take that approach because that didn't work, wouldn't work, and we need all kinds of advances. As I said, we would like it if more than just Flagship applied this approach. You need many elements. You need this culture that will tolerate this kind of risk. You need a similar methodology, I would think, things like platforms. And mostly you need people who are willing to do science in this way. I think, as I have great admiration for the scientists that we have at our bench, because they, most of them come with a PhD, some with an MD, and so they have a field that they know well, but they're willing to say, you know, I'm going to work on, let's say, mRNA for 2 years, and then when something else comes along, I'll switch. Well, that's not typical for scientific careers. So you have to find people like that, and then you have to create an atmosphere in which they'll do it. And of course, like all of biotech and venture, you need the oxygen to keep everything alive. Namely, you need the capital. And so you need investors who are long-term and sophisticated and willing to say, it's okay, I'm willing to invest longer term for the value that you might create using this approach.
That's very true and informative. So Mike, so summer this year, one of the big news for Flagship is you close a massive round, like $3.4 billion. Congrats on that. So do you think that a signal either investors' confidence in Flagship through what Moderna has accomplished during a pandemic, or do you think that it shows a broader appetite on more innovation in the biotech and the pharmaceutical at all?
Yeah, I would say and instead of or. So I think it is a vote of confidence that the Flagship methodology has proved itself. And there are people now willing to invest, thinking, well, maybe there'll be another Moderna or there'll be other companies like it. They seem to have, they've got a track record and they have a way in which they increase their probability of more successes. But it's also a moment where thank goodness, this is biotechnology's moment. I mean, look at it. We've literally saved the world, or we're in the process of saving the world. This is sort of like dot-com, or even better than dot-com 20 years ago. Now, biotechnology is no longer just a boutique sector. People are paying attention to it and its potential. And as you said, you know, everybody knows a name like Moderna. You know, the bus driver knows Moderna. Probably the bus driver in India knows Moderna. So this is our moment. And I think you're seeing a reflection of that in the willingness of capital to go into this field where it might have ignored it in the past.
I'm very happy also this moment come as a life science investor as well.
Yes, you should be.
So last question, Mike. So today we have a lot of audience as entrepreneurs or scientists who are working on their own startup. So they are probably also hoping for some advice building their own successful company. So any advice you would like to share with them?
Oh, you know, so much advice, some from hard-earned experiences. I think number one is I can't imagine success without a champion. So there are so many obstacles between where you start and a successful finish that you really have to believe. It's a very hard road. And so number one is, do you really believe it? And if you really believe it, you'll need to motivate all kinds of other people, scientists that you recruit, other people in your staff, investors, the outside world, regulators eventually, So I would say number one is believe. Number two is remember that it's very hard to get it perfectly right the first time. So we need to, of course, we need to de-risk situations, and different companies have different ways of doing it. But don't outsmart yourself. Don't be so smart that you don't start anything, or you only start things that in the end, you know, may not be any different or may be incremental. Because remember, if you're coming with only small advances, there may also be competition that looks quite similar. And so don't de-risk things too much. And then thirdly, I would say, to the extent that you can create a culture, either by the way you speak and act and the team you gather around you, culture is very important to success, because you'll encounter a lot of challenges and a lot of failures along the way. But if you have a culture that believes in what you're doing and tolerates some failure and risk, you'll increase your chances of success.
Those are valuable and insightful advice, Mike. So now we come to the end of this fireside chat. And I would like to thank you, Mike, again for your great sharing and also thoughts. Hope this section will be also beneficial for everyone today. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. It's an honor.